Dear students, in this module, we will discuss and learn about case control and evaluation studies in detail. The themes to be covered here are meaning and importance of case control and evaluation studies, types of case control and evaluation studies, steps to carry out case control studies, strengths and weaknesses of case control studies, advantages and disadvantages of different evaluation studies. First, we will discuss about the case control studies, its meaning and importance. A case control study is a type of observational study design in which the researcher does not alter the exposure status. Instead, the researcher sets out only to measure the exposure. For example, in this case, suppose smoking is exposure and outcome, example may be cancer, to in study participants and studies their association. In a case control study, participants are selected for the study based on their outcome status, that is suffering from cancer, for example. Thus, some participants have the outcome of interest referred here as cases, whereas others do not have the outcome of interest referred here as controls. The researcher then assesses the exposure in both these groups. Hence, in a case control study, the outcome has to have occurred to some of the participants who have been included in the study. See the definition of case control study given by Fortras, the Dictionary of Epidemiology. According to this, the case control study is an observational epidemiological study of persons with the disease or another outcome variable of interest and a suitable control group of persons without the diseases, that is comparative group or reference group. It further elaborates the potential relationship of a suspected risk factor or an attribute to the disease is examined by comparing the diseased and non-diseased subjects with regard to how frequently the factor or attribute is present, or if qualitative, the levels of attributes in each of the groups, that is diseased and non-diseased. For example of a case control study, if a study is trying to show that people who smoke, that is the attribute, and more likely to be diagnosed with lung cancer, the outcome. Here, the cases would be persons with lung cancer and the controls would be persons without lung cancer, but not necessarily healthy, and some of each group would be smokers. If a large proportion of cases smoke than the controls, that suggests but does not conclusively show that the hypothesis is valid, that is those who smoke are more likely to be diagnosed with lung cancer. Thus, a case control study by and large is a retrospective study that looks back in time to find out the relative risk between a specific exposure, that is example second hand tobacco smoke, and an outcome, that is maybe a cancer. A control group of people who do not have the disease or who did not experience the event is used for comparison. The major aim of this study design is to figure out the relationship between risk factors and disease or outcome and estimate the odds of an individual getting a disease or experiencing an event. Now, we will move upon to the types of case control studies. Based on the selection of controls, there are two types of case control studies. One is non-matched case control study, the other one is matched case control study. In the case of non-matched case control study, this is a simplest form. A person with the disease is enrolled in the study and a person in the nature of control, that is one without the disease, is also enrolled and their exposure status is determined. Next one is about matched case control study. In this type, at first a person with the disease is enrolled, then the person is matched for some characteristic, for example, age, sex, weight, etc., with a control, that is another person with who does not have the disease. This can eliminate or minimize confounding variables. However, it generally results in a longer study, that is, the more characteristics being matched, the longer the study takes, the more conclusive, that is, definite results. We will now move to steps to carry out case control studies. Number one, selection of cases. The study begins by enrolling people who generally have a certain disease or outcome, that is, cases. This requires a clear case definition, and care is needed. The bias does not arise from the way in which cases are selected. Generally, cases will be selected from hospital and or other surgery cards and pertaining to sudden outbreaks of certain diseases, for example, cholera, dengue, etc., and the study of rare diseases like HIV/AIDS, breast cancer, etc. Next step is the selection of controls. Selection of control group is very essential, which generally used to be selected on a sample basis, preferably from a population identical in every way to the case group, except that they don't have the disease or condition being studied. Strictly speaking, selection of aggregate controls is more problematic. Factors such as age, sex, time of hospitalization that are chosen to be definite conditions of similarity between controls and cases are called the matching criteria. The selected control group must be at similar risk to each other of developing the outcome. Controls need not be in good health. Inclusion of sick people is sometimes appropriate, as the control group should represent those at risk of becoming a case. Controls should come from the same population as the cases, and their selection should be independent of the exposure of interest. General population and hospital records mostly serve this purpose. Another aspect to be looked into is the size of controls. Generally, it is advisable for a case control rate of 1:1. However, at times this ratio varies and may increase to 1:2, depending on cause incurred and increase in the statistical power required. At times, more than one control group of case can be also be studied. The next step in case control study is collection of data. After the selection of cases and controls, the researchers should decide on the data to be collected, and the same data must be collected in the same way from both the groups. The researcher should be objective in collecting data with regard to past risk factors, since the outcome is already known. Though it is difficult, the researcher should take care in masking the outcome from the person who is collecting the risk factor information or interviewing patients. Sometimes it will be necessary to interview patients about potential factors such as history of smoking, diet, use of traditional eye medicines, etc., in their past, which may not be possible to collect accurately from some people. At times, patients who have the outcome, that is, cases, are likely to scrutinize the past, remembering details of negative exposures more closely than controls, which is known as recall bias. The researcher has to minimize this type of bias so as to strengthen the study. The next step in case control study is analysis of data. Most of the analysis in case control studies is computation of odds ratios, that is the strength of association between an exposure and the outcome. Of course, it is better first to include the frequency of each of the measured variables in each of the two groups. An odds ratio is the ratio of the odds of an exposure in the case group to the odds of exposure to the control group. The odds ratio have to be supported with the computation of confidence intervals that facilitates to interpret whether the odds ratios between exposure and outcome variables across the cases and control groups are statistically significant or not. These calculations are mostly done with computer program like APINFO, SPSS, Stata, etc. At times, researchers will make use of conditional logistic regression analysis to compute the odds ratios. For here, an example is given for case control study, which has been done by researchers in UK. Dahl and Dahl during 1950s have carried out a pioneering case control study in UK to examine the link between tobacco smoking and lung cancer. They included 709 patients who had lung cancer, that is who had lung carcinoma defined as cases. Then they also included 708 controls from general medical and surgical patients. The selected controls were similar to the cases with respect to age and sex. Thus, they included 649 males and 60 females each of as cases as well as controls. They found that only 0.3% of males were non-smoking among cases. However, the proportion of non-smokers among controls was 4.2%. The difference was statistically highly significant. Similarly, they found that about 31.7% of the females were non-smokers in cases compared with 53.3% in controls. This difference was also statistically significant at 0.01 level. In population studies, case studies have been carried out in the research related to HIV/AIDS and family planning program so as to find out the diseases related to IUDs. Now we will move upon to the strengths of case control studies. Case control studies can be conducted faster and findings can be obtained quickly. Case control studies can often be undertaken with minimum funding and inexpensively. Case control studies are efficient to study rare diseases. Case control studies can study multiple exposures in the same outcome. Case control studies generally requires few study subjects. Case control studies are useful to study the association of risk factors and outcomes in outbreak investigations. Case control studies can answer questions that could not be answered through other study designs. Coming to the weaknesses side of case control studies cannot generate or estimate incidence or prevalence of diseases. They are subject to bias, both recall as well as retrospective biases. They are difficult if record keeping is either inadequate or unavailable. Case control studies also, the weaknesses side, selection of control can be difficult. Now we will move upon to evaluation studies, that is meaning and importance. First we will see, evaluation is a selective exercise that attempts to systematically and objectively assess progress towards the achievement of an outcome. Generally, evaluation studies may be defined as those studies that look into the process of aggregating and analyzing various types and forms of data to evaluate the outcome of the project, vice the inputs used. Evaluation research connotes the use of research methods to evaluate programs or services and determine how effectively they are achieving their goals. It is also known as program evaluation and or impact evaluation. We will see the definitions of evaluation. Wahlberg and Hazel defined evaluation as a careful, rigorous examination of an intervention, program, institution, organizational variable or policy. The focus is on understanding and improving the thing evaluated, as we do in the case of formative evaluation, or in summarizing, describing or judging planned and unplanned outcomes in the form of summative evaluation. In the words of Lal Das, evaluation is a systematic assessment of progress made by the implementing machinery, an analysis of problem and difficulties arising in the effective implementation of a program, and an indication of the collective measures necessary. It also provides information about the outcomes of programs and judgments regarding the desirability or value of programs. Generally, two broad types of evaluations are there. One is formative evaluation, the second one is summative evaluation. While coming to formative evaluation, this type of evaluation provides the initial feedback needed to strengthen or improve the object or intervention of policy formulation. It would help in examining the delivery of the program or technology, the quality of its implementation, and the assessment of the organizational context, personnel, procedures, inputs, and so on. It focuses on providing information to guide the planning, development, and implementation of a specific program, and thereby ensure that a program or program activity is feasible, appreciate, and acceptable before it is fully implemented. It is usually conducted when a new program or activity is being developed or when an existing one is being adapted or modified. There are different ways of formative evaluation. First one is needs assessment. It determines the programmer's needs from the perspective of all stakeholders, looking into aspects such as how great the need is and what might work to meet the need. Secondly, feasibility and evaluability assessment. It helps to determine whether an evaluation or a program policy is feasible for implementation. It also analyzes both the technical and financial viability of an intervention program. Thirdly, structured conceptualization. It will be useful to stakeholders to define the program or technology, the target population, and the possible outcomes. Fourthly, implementation evaluation. This type of evaluation helps in monitoring the dependability of the program or technology delivery. Fifthly, the process evaluation. It investigates the process of delivering the program or outputs or technology. Here, the major focus is to evaluate the impact of an intervention on process indicators. On the whole, formative evaluation research is helpful in measuring awareness of existing services and knowledge about intervention strategies so as to initiate the program or providing intervention among targeted populations. Generally, qualitative research methods such as case histories, participant observation, focus group discussion, brainstorming, etc. are used in these studies. Coming to the advantages of formative evaluative studies, firstly, they emphasize the parts instead the whole entity. Events are recent, thus of marking accuracy and preventing alteration by time. The results can be used to improve the program or modify the program plan before its full implementation begins. Disadvantages side, these studies make judgment before the activity is completed. These studies interrupt the flow of outcomes. There are chances for a false sense of security when formative evaluation is positive. Now, we will move upon to summative evaluation. This type of evaluation is the most used, which will involves assessing the impact of the program or examine the effects of outcomes of some object. This type of research summarizes by describing what happens subsequent to the delivery of the program or technology and assesses whether the object can be said to have caused the outcome, determines the overall impact of the causal factor beyond only the immediate target outcomes, and estimates the relative cost associated with the object intervention. The summative evaluation also of different types. Firstly, the outcome evaluation. It analyzes whether the program or technology caused effects or impact on defined target outcomes as expected. Impact evaluation, it will ascertain and assess the overall of or net effects of the program or technology as a whole by looking into the projects, activities and the tasks implemented. Thirdly, cost effectiveness and cost benefit analysis. It will address questions regarding the efficiency of the program and benefits achieved there, that is outcomes, in comparison to the costs that are going to be involved and are incurred. Fifthly, secondary analysis. It examines existing data to address new questions or use methods not precisely employed. Meta-analysis. It integrates the outcome estimates from multiple studies to arrive at an overall or summary judgment on an evaluation question. Overall, these types of evaluation focuses on the after effects of the program or intervention made and or benefits achieved with regard to those for whom the program or intervention is intended. Summative evaluation are basically used for policy making or decision making, such as whether or to continue, expand or cancel a program. These studies require mainly quantitative data and often makes use of advanced statistical methods as well as econometrics methods. Now, we will discuss a few words about types of evaluation designs. For carrying out evaluation studies, three broad evaluation designs are often used, which are discussed in this section. Firstly, randomized experiments. Secondly, quasi-experimental designs. And thirdly, the non-experimental designs. Coming to the randomized experiments is of two types. First one is pre-test, post-test with random assignment to intervention or comparison groups. In these experiments, the study subjects, that are groups, are randomly assigned to a group or which one group receives an interpretation or intervention or a program. They are coined as a study or treatment group, and another to a control and another to a comparison group that does not receive the intervention or program, which is coined as control or non-treatment group. Data for each group are collected before and after the intervention program. At the end of the experiment, differences between the intervention and comparison groups can be attributed directly to the effect of the intervention, that is, if its sample is large enough. Here, randomization ensures that the intervention and comparison groups are equivalent with respect to all factors, often that whatever they received the intervention. In other words, the comparison group serves as the counterfactual of what would have happened in the absence of the program. The second type of randomized evaluation test is post-test only design. These type of experimental design assumes that the groups are randomly assigned before the intervention begins. The data will be collected at the end of the program only from both the groups and compared to see the effect of the intervention. Coming to the limitations of randomized designs, they are difficult and at times and not feasible in real world situations and scenarios. It is unethical to offer the intervention to the group but not to the other group. Spillover effects can result in the comparison group being exposed to the intervention. High rates of dropouts may occur in both the groups, which can bias the results. Other often expensive and thereby less feasible to implement. The second type of experimental designs are quasi-experimental designs. These type of designs are also like the previous ones, but the assignment of subjects or groups into intervention and comparison groups is not on a random basis and are non-random. Thus, evaluators cannot assume equivalence between these two groups. Instead, they must assess the differences of baseline and end line account for any demographic or behavioral differences in the analysis. Comparison groups in the quasi-experimental design can be identified through matching, such as a process of identifying individuals who are similar to the participants in the intervention group on all relevant characteristics, such as age, sex, religion, and other factors associated with the program exposure. These designs are also two types, like the previous one, pre-test and post-test, with the non-random assignment through intervention on control groups, and secondly, post-test only with the non-random assignment. The procedure of data collection and other things are the same as noted in the previous designs. Coming to the limitations of quasi-experimental designs, firstly, selecting matching participants with the similar characteristics for the groups is very difficult. The post-test only designs are somewhat weaker designs. The third type of evaluation designs are the non-experimental designs. Here, only intervention, that is one group, will be studied. Evaluators choose to use non-experimental designs when there are resource constraints or when they are unable to form an appropriate comparison group or when a program covers the entire population and thus there is no comparison group, such as with a mass media campaign. Four commonly used non-experimental designs are pre-test and post-test designs, wherein evaluators survey the intervention group before and after the intervention. While evaluators may observe changes in outcome indicators among the intervention participants, they cannot attribute all these changes to the intervention alone using this design because there is no comparison group. Secondly, time series designs. Evaluators look for changes over time to determine trends. Here, evaluators observe the intervention group multiple times before and after the intervention and analyze trends before and after. Thirdly, the longitudinal studies. This is another type of time series design. Here, evaluators take repeated measures of the same variable and from the same people. A panel design is a special type of longitudinal design in which evaluators track a similar group of people at multiple points in time and record their experiences in great detail. And fourthly, post-test only design. Though through this type of design, evaluators observe the intervention group at the point of time after the intervention, focusing particularly on comparing responses of subgroups based on such characteristics as age, sex, ethnicity, education or level of exposure to the intervention. This is the weakest approach among the evaluation designs. Coming to the limitations of non-experimental designs, these are weakest designs of evaluation type of research. Evaluators must have a clear conceptual understanding and need a robust framework. Without a comparison group, it is difficult for evaluators to determine what would have happened in the absence or the intervention. Students, in this module, a detailed discussion is made about the different aspects of case control and evaluation studies, like meaning and importance of case control studies and evaluation studies, different types of both of these studies, procedures of followed to carry out both case control and evaluation studies, strength and weaknesses of both these type of studies. Thank you.